Welcome, everybody. So basically, building capacity for conservation in Equatorial Guinea. I am from the Fisheries and Aquatic Science Department, so conservation was not like in my curriculum, not even in my master's or my PhD here. And I already said that in 2004-05, I got some issues trying to get the TCD certificate, whatever, but it's okay right now because I'm working on conservation. So WCS decided to start working on Caribbean. It's a Spanish-speaking country in this is the only Spanish-speaking country in Africa. It's in Africa, right over there is latitude one, so it's pretty much equatorial. Some justice. There is 13 protected areas in the country. The country itself is small, 20,000 square kilometers, like one Africa. It is divided in the continental part, in the a little island. There is several islands, but the island that is more known is the Malabo Island, which is, I didn't put it here because in this one I'm trying to highlight the areas where the WCS is working. So Bioko Island is probably the most common. There is a lot of work on mammals in the island, including any mammals and also some of the freshwater fish fauna, which is something that I work with. We're actually working in the continental part. We're working in three areas, Rio Campo, Punta Ilende, and a little one here, which I can see. I mean, not even this one, this area is enough, big enough to sustain any medium-sized mammal population. You isolate it completely. No? The good thing about this area is actually completely close to Cameroon. That actually helps take a picture of an area for conservation. This is the area that eventually WCS will have to move on if they want to work with the wildlife itself. This is Parque Nacional Monte Alen and Natural Reserve Rio Muni, and this is connected to a big reserve here from Gabon. So that area, and if you Google the Equatorial Guinea and with protected areas, the first thing that's going to come along is going to be Monte Alen, which is the part that has been working for 15 years. The protected area law was enacted in 2003, so this park was actually working that already. So it was incorporated into the lab and then created the whole system around. So as you can see, the areas of this, I think in the total area of Equatorial Guinea and size within the African continent is really small. But that, saying that, it is got a really huge biological importance, this area per se. 2014, Timothy Tier, which is now the Executive Director of Africa in WCS. He and some other colleagues produced a paper about investment in Africa, where your work is going to work on situation. Basically, the area that is in the middle, the only area that is in the middle is South Cameroon, Equatorial Guinea, and Gabon, which have a complement of high freshwater diversity, which is part of the Congo River, high terrestrial diversity, which is part of the Gulf of Guinea, marine. The importance in Gulf of Guinea and the currents, and also it has a mix of all those areas together. So this is really an important area and where your hog will actually produce really biodiversity conservation compared to other areas. So, if I'm talking too fast, somebody can give me a sign because I get excited sometimes. Even in Spanish, people be fine. My mother's talk, but even with that one, I speak so fast. So we have 13 protected areas, the one that I was telling you. We have issues with weak in the four. I mean, this is the national agency in charge of the protected areas. We have pretty much no presence in the field. The capacity is really low. There is only a couple of people with university degree from overseas, actually, because we can recognize degrees. And that's probably the reason that some of these people focusing on certain procedural administrative stuff instead of thinking strategically or the long term. The protected areas, they are mostly on paper, which is something that is not uncommon for protected areas around the world. put on paper and then leave it over there, enforcement, budget, and everything else coming behind for lack. The management plan will be outdated in most of the areas, and probably not sure about the table over there that was produced by Central African Bank, RAPAC, which is another agency from Central Africa. And it is something that we need to figure out how to produce this strategic planning at some point that we can use this paper. Have it, use it to guide the whatever we're doing in Decadize. So let me, instead of talking all the time, I'm going to show you a little video that we produce.
Laptop on this.
So this is just to highlight the that we just knew on the content we're trying to actually make an impact on conservation. And this is like almost like a 30 seconds, like almost like an elevator video that you can actually say, okay, this is what we're doing here, and highlight the approach that we're taking over. I mean, Wildlife Conservation Society, Equatorial Guinea is probably the only program that is actually working with agricultural issues within the protected areas, which is kind of new, you know, wildlife, right? Protected areas, agriculture, but we were actually supporting the subsistence agriculture and fishing stuff. We like saying fishing stuff because we're not only working with the subsistence fisheries in the protected areas, we're also working with the government, trying to regulate industrial fishing and trying to get it outside of the protected areas. So that is really actually highlight the what we're actually doing over there. But it also talks a little bit about some kind of a change in the philosophy of the space, because in this time they are working with people trying to achieve conservation. They're not just trying to force law in protected areas or in the parks. And that's something that's probably got involved in the Equatorial Guinea thing. Also, I speak Spanish, that's what I tell everybody. So, Institutional Conservation NGO, there are some NGOs already working, Conservation International works over there. And 2013, we have a project with a global World Bank, basically a SNAP, the system of protected areas over there. Eco Guinea is a Spaniard NGO. They have connection Spain and Equatorial Guinea, and they are the ones that actually help us to put videos. And they is the Association of the Desarrollo Equatorial, and that one is this is the only national NGO that works with this conservation. And it's basically people from the world that actually create this NGO. They can absorb regional funding that wants national NGO, the only way they actually work in. So it was a very clear idea, and it probably happened in that a lot of people that work on the and they have like a dive into that work they collaborate with. BBPP, which is the Bioko Biodiversity Protection Program, sent by a couple of universities in the United States and England. The farmers, but now they are getting into management of protected areas in the island. And also the Tomaje, which is Tortugas Marina de Guinea Equatorial. And they've been working over there 10 years ago. It was created by a research from the partnership, PhD on tourism and everything. Hola Tomaje and Ecovinea and also Andeje are over here. They don't have any legal status. So they only have the name and the individuals, but everything else is outside or some gray area in Ecovinea that they are not really legal, so it's to get some kind of agreement with them to the government. Probably the reason is that it's so difficult to get something. Because every single group that people want to create over there, the government thinks that's going to be used to because it's a democracy, actually, because 37 years, but there's no democracy 37 years, it's like a leadership, but these guys, they have elections past April. There's so many issues in the elections that I'm not even going to that, but all of that is that organizing groups in Cotabini is really difficult. Even the groups that we work with, culturally, it's really difficult to get some kind of legal status. We're trying to work with local government to create some kind of framework for these groups to work, be recognized, but still, it is really difficult. That part. So I already showed the video. So WCS went over there in 2012. They did a bunch of groundwork in getting a lot of psychological information, getting everything that they can get, biological information. They decided to approach two things, working with people, of course, trying to better manage natural resources and building this institutional capacity. And that's, of course, those two are going to be time, though. I'm going to focus right now on the building institutional capacity. Basically, we want the Indefor staff to be able to carry like a critical management tasks. And as critical is the one that will be happening in the affected areas. And we can have probably a class trying to define which one are critical and which one not, though. But in terms of this one, we're just trying to get, you know, some presence in the field, some kind of extension or extension working on those communities that are within the protected area, not even outside, just the ones that are within the protected area, trying to get a sense of what kind of activities they do and everything, anything that's related to uses in the protected area. Now, in defining critical policy and legal issues, and that's what I'm here this past week. We create a kind of group here with a microphone in bed and a lawyer from Costa Rica to make a review of the environmental protected areas law. And there were so many issues before, and some of them were resolved by itself because of the government switch. They create ministries and they destroy some of the ministries. So part of the issue that we have is what we got resolved with that. So now we're just trying to get the new legal framework for protected areas, try to make it stronger, try to make it strong. The people that is important right now in the board is good and they are keen to communication, but the challenge is to create this legal framework in a way that they have some kind of safeguards that the people that they are not keen to consider getting there, because we definitely want to stronger in the board. But we're gonna make it as strong that if the people switch, it will be against WCS or against conservation in this case, because the WCS, we're just thinking about our conservation, but just thinking on the country, if we give in the port enough power in the legal part, but then this institution changed it. It happened before, like two directors ago, the person that was there was just giving the area to whatever they needed to friends and family. So you need to make it stronger legal, but at the same time have enough safeguards to be able to achieve conservation with boundary. I mean, right now it's on paper, it's still on paper, a lot of these things happen, but we need to actually make it stronger. And then this is for this group, this is the marker zone with the clinical conservation. Okay. Clinic in Costa Rica. We send the deputy and the work from the trying to make a idea of how we approach this problem. part of the plan that they invest, it was trying to harmonize to different ministries, which actually the government flashed, actually created a new super ministry, including those two. So that problem was gone, but at that point, we invested the time trying to do that. So this is now. So right now, in the four fields that there are limiting issues on law that allow them to enforce or to help them to create really effective conservation. And of course, part of the same objectives is to help them to work really in a sustainable way, a sustainable approach for the limited, truly limited human and also financial resources. As you know, Equatorial Guinea, probably Equatorial Guinea is going to be one of the most important Central African oil countries. That sense. It is not that much. Global production is probably less than 1%. But still, for the country, it's 95% of the total economy. So, pretty much they depend on oil. So, they were in high tide, you know, with the gas at $4, you know, basically 150 the barrel, projects and everything. You know, they didn't care about it before the US giving some money and everything. But 2 years ago, the oil crash, and now they are like counting every bean that they can. So even though you think about conservation and you think about oil prices, there is a really strong link at least for the country. They have a strategic plan for the country, that's Vision 2020, and they want to stop the dependence on oil. They kind of create alternatives. So one of them is fishing, which is one of the things that we're working, the other one is tourism. Now, with the fishing part, what they did is they are bringing some kind of industrial fleet from Spain and China, and they're trying to just start working on the waters, which creates an issue with the community that they were using these waters so long, and they don't have the fear of this people will do them. And then the second one will be tourism, but this is probably the country to get. You need a letter from the National Security Ministry, even if you want to go as a tourist. I mean, if you want to visit your money to Africa and they give you all these paperwork issues, you will probably say, oh, I'm just going to Cameroon, it's cheaper and it's exactly the same university, and probably exactly the same everything. So why? And then you Google, you know, this country in the world, and in Equatorial comes in purpose. And that's probably the reason. I mean, they got 1 million persons over there, and they got less than one visitor for every two people. While countries like Costa Rica, they have six visitors for every inhabitant of Costa Rica. So that makes like a little issue thinking, and they're trying to move from oil to some other activities, but at the same time, they don't have facility. And that's probably also responsible. Kind of government and whatever they find to do, they find to keep. The president right now is 77 years old and he got reelected for another 7 years. I don't know if he's going to survive those 7 years or not, there's a lot of pressure on him, but he's trying to pass the whatever power he got into. And that creates another issue for him, but that's probably the reason that they want to keep the country closed, not opening. So, in the fourth window, WCS went over there and they were trying to kind of get like a little input in budget to do to report, trying to help them. But there's some issue. Going to the government, they would actually go away without having it. So the only way to make them kind of it is to make it some kind of grants to them. So we create these grants, eco grants, to the government. So the government is the only one, government or NGOs from Equatorial Guinea, they can apply to these grants. If we review it, we have a steering committee on top of WCS Equatorial Guinea. And the steering committee is one people from WCS in New York, one people from Rome, one people from the port. So these people decide pretty much where this money can go. So far, we don't have any issue because the grant that they apply is one or two. We don't have enough of them, but then we actually convert some of the activity into LICO grants, but it has a lot of input from WCS. And what we want is to gain the capacity of them to produce objectives, methods, and results that they want to produce with this money. And that's really difficult when you think about the level of education happening there. But so far we got some of them. In the fort has six actually departments. One of them is the National Herbarium. They create something for create a database for that. The first question that I asked when I got to the department is, so what is the representation of vegetation in the country? Yeah, basically they have any database. So he told me the later told me, oh, we take like a 3 months to produce something based on what we have in your company and put the lady. So we went back and tried to figure out what was happening, but there were no database, not even an Excel one. So this project was created basically to create a database and give that some information you want to use stuff that we use here every day, like pivot tables and filters and stuff, just trying to figure out what exactly we have within the protected areas and outside the protected areas. That project was actually a pretty nice success. We worked at the Community Development Fishing and Culture, just providing materials to help them to improve fishing and agriculture. Right now, it is kind of a rudimental. I mean, if you compare Cameroon, which is across the country, the agricultural part, they produce, I would say, probably 10 to 15 times in the same area for what the compared in the goals are produced. I mean, basically, we're talking about food security. They will die. Everything comes from Cameroon. Even fishing, like it's supposed to be good in Equatorial Guinea, they import fish from Cameroon and in Gabon, frozen fish in some of the markets. So this actually was also a nice project. We worked with the directors, they call it conservators of the air, the communities, and we provide them with materials for better fishing and better agriculture. So I told you the WCS is here actually trying to incentive agriculture, which for me was difficult at the beginning. Because I'm coming from Guatemala, we're trying to stop agriculture because this is usually what is a great issue though. So Tomaje, we're working with some extension project. We're trying to produce some material. They got material before that, but it was some negative extension, basically turtle, dead turtles, sort of stuff like that. Material. So don't kill me, don't do that. So now we're trying to say, okay, these are the turtles and we want, it's good to have turtles, this is what they do, this is where they are, this is what they can do, what they can help us. And so we're producing that with Tomaje. And the good thing about this one is it's a good example because the U.S. Embassy in Guinea, they decided to support this project. So it's half WCS, half the U.S. Embassy. I didn't even know that the embassy, they have $50,000, $30,000. Everything is so expensive in that place that, I mean, that not going to use a lot, but have some material. And then Andeje got another project from the National Central Bank of Central Africa, and they were basically building facilities for Chiocampo, one of the areas that we're working. They under budget facilities because they were trying to out a company with local people, but the bank didn't allow them to hire a company, and that was by 50%. So they decided to use it. Basically, we provided 25% of the budget, and World Bank to get provided the other 25%, and then the bank provided 50%. So now the facilities are almost running. They are about to be open. And for 2016, we're trying to create another eco grant with GIS, basically trying to get some ground trust points, but to see vegetation, wetland, like that, create some kind of a more detailed it so far, and then a vegetation survey because the herbarium created the database, so now we have an idea of what we have, but we know that there is a bunch of pretty much the most of part. That's what we're working on. We're trying to go back and try to get survey general part and trying to bring a sample that Payne took like 15 years ago. Also something the herbarium in Spain, they never sent back the information. Now we can try to get a some kind of coming back, putting the national repairing, but also bringing some of the papers, some vegetation mapping in the coastal part. So I was telling you that we were working with some kind of land use. This is kind of the standard in America, pressure of land, at least in Central America and South Mexico. But it seems like it's not the case here. I mean, from 2001 to 2016, if you combine these two numbers here, the 8 and the 4, this is somewhat like 15 square kilometers. And that's probably pretty much 1 square kilometer per year, which is less than 0.3% deforestation rate. That's really, I mean, if you compare to other countries, that's massive. That is, taking that into account, pretty much what happened is that the country, after the boom of the oil prices, the infrastructure actually got better. So a lot of the roads were created. So as you can see the roads over here, that's pretty much what happened and everything around the roads. There is a couple of things that are new here. Like they didn't know there is pygmales, or I don't know how to say that word in English, pygmales community over here. And they are creating a lot of deforestation here. And also in this part, they thought that it was really small, but it's kind of big. This is almost like a private stuff farmland over there. But still, even with that change in Rio Campo, it is completely like small compared to what happened in other countries. So one other thing that we notice is that the wetlands, as you can see over here, they go up and down, and it's probably related to wind parks. Precipitation stations or weather stations, they are non-existent pretty much on the country except for the airport. So that is really hard to relate this to what's happening. But still, as you can see over there by wetland, it's pretty much, there's a difference of 3 square kilometers, and that's basically almost all getting big and small, but not really something big that we can relate to that one though. And of course, with that one. So that was part of the approach. The second approach is working with communities. And what we're trying to do is trying to create strong communities so they can be enforced allies about new invasions or good people moving to their areas. This is wonderful paper the work, because a lot of times these people actually create this underground economy, and they sell the lands, or they sell whatever the new people are going to try to come establish. But still, we're trying to work with these people, and we're trying to support them in agricultural and fishing part, and trying to get something good with them. Part of the deal with this is creating knowledge of community. What is in the fort? Because we go to the communities within the protected areas, whether we're coming from in the fort, and the first question they ask, which company, which oil company? But they don't even know what in the fort is. And so we're trying to create some kind of videos, and we're going to try to go community, try to tell them that, okay, you are inside a protected area, and this is what's happening. Some people know, but a lot of the people in the community, they don't know. I mean, if we just gather them, we project a small video like the one that. I'm not going to show the whole video, I'm just going to show a little piece of it. And I'm sorry, this one is in Spanish because the whole group is talking about that. Basically, what we're trying to say here is, okay, this is in the four communities.
Las áreas protegidas de Guinea Ecuatorial son uno de los mayores tesoros del país. Sus bosques antiguos, el mar que las baña, los grandes ríos y los miles de animales que en ellas se cobijan suponen la garantía de un futuro saludable para todos los ecuatorianos. Para mantener esta gran riqueza de todos, el gobierno de Guinea Ecuatorial creó en el año 2002 el INDEFORAPE, la institución que día a día trabaja para proteger estas zonas.
El INDEFOR es un Instituto Nacional de Desarrollo Forestal y Gestión del Sistema de Áreas Protegidas. Entonces estamos velando por la conservación de la naturaleza para que la gente conozca el valor de bosques,
Para llevar a cabo esta titánica tarea, el INDEFOR APEI cuenta con más de 125 trabajadores, tanto en su sede de Bata como en las 13 áreas protegidas que se encuentran repartidas por todo el territorio nacional. Botánicos, técnicos medioambientales, conservadores, ecoguardas y un sinfín de profesionales trabajando para proteger eficazmente la biodiversidad del país. Para aprovechar mejor sus recursos, el INDEFOR APEI ha llegado a acuerdos con otras instituciones que apoyan técnica y económicamente su labor. Una de ellas es la ONG WCS, que desde el año 2012 colabora con el INDEFOR APEI en la costa de la región continental, apoyando la conservación de tres áreas protegidas: Río Campo, Playa Nenji y Punta Ilente. Estas tres zonas poseen una destacada importancia medioambiental, ya que en ellas anidan gran cantidad de tortugas marinas, además de albergar otros animales en peligro de extinción y proveer servicios esenciales para vivir. Sin embargo, a pesar de los esfuerzos del INDEFOR APEI y de las leyes que prohíben cazar estas especies o extraer madera de estas zonas, los estudios demuestran que tanto la superficie de bosque como la cantidad de animales decrece año a año. Entonces, ¿qué está
pasando? So as you can see, we're trying to actually go into the communities and show them, okay, this is in the port, this is what we work, but still everything is happening. And is, I mean, you take the trip from Bata, which is the city, you know, in the north, and you find like every Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 15 to 25 homes with animals just came from. And I mean, if you want to bring tourists, the first thing that you want to see is those animals hanging over there, and you're going to be like, oh, I'm not going there. I even see some people freaking out, ah, I don't want to be, I don't want to come here, you know, because, I mean, it is difficult to show that kind of stuff, though. But that is what we have to deal right now. So, in order to help the communities, we want to achieve, actually, improvements in quality of life. And this is really the problem here in the world, because it's difficult to measure how you're going to improve quality of life. I mean, probably a bunch of PhD here, and how you measure that is completely difficult. And there is a lot of tools that you can use, but still, even with those tools, it's difficult to measure quality of life. One of the best examples here in Florida is CRP, when they banned gillnets, they switched to oyster farms. And they did quality of life next 5 years, and they got some kind of nice stuff to show them. But still, I mean, it is difficult, so but that's what we're trying to do. We're going to improve farming and fishing, and we're going to improve the conditions in access to the market. We just have a consultant for market value. She got a nice approach of chain value, which means not only see the increasing production, but see exactly where it's going and how it's going, where we can actually intervene to increase the production or basically the price, or transform the product instead of selling the whole fish. We can sell part of the fish and then get a little better price. Of course, involved in all this is trying to do the management of resources and also create a local management by the people. They usually do it in a way that they local management, but they say, yeah, okay, this is the area that we're going to do agriculture, this is the area where we extract products from the forest, and this is the area that we fish. So they already have a notion of that, and we just need to make it official and make it the government to respect that kind of thinking. Of course, we cannot work in all the areas. We're working on two of the protected areas. We work with two consejos and six rural villages. One of the villages actually got, it is one, but it was supposed to be six. So Punta Embonda, Dibolo, and Dode, Hanje, y Pume. Pume down there is the only one that is outside of the area. Like a blank. I mean, to see what's happening inside versus what's happening outside of the area. Of course, Veronica is part of the creation of some of these slides. Veronica, yes, she's over there. And what we're trying to do is basically identify what kind of fisheries and stuff we can get. But at the end, there is two things that we want to do, food security and access to market. Because if they produce more, but they can actually sell what they produce, it's going to be important. They're not going to get truly quality by getting better, though. Of course, we have to get several steps. Now, we already did this part. We already have this part. This part is about to come. Jasmine Quintana from the SNRE, she's going to be in Equatorial Guinea for a couple of months and trying to get this measurements stuff. And then we're going to try to come back 5 years or 4 years later and try to see how much improvement we got in the people's life, which is going to be tough. I mean, 5 years sounds like a lot of time, but it's a window to see those improvements. Probably in the United States, with CRT case, 5 years was enough, but I'm really doubting that we have enough time to really measure what's going to happen with them. I mean, so far they got some of the help with the materials, but to really see that improvement, we're going to have to work a little bit more I'm sorry, this is funny because it was also for the people in Equatorial Guinea, but there are a lot of things that we need to help on. There is no equipment, there is no organization at all, but that's probably because of the governmental issues with the organized groups. Transport, which is, they have a nice really infrastructure in both, and now that they have enough cars from communities going out to bring any kind of fishing or agricultural. And also, of course, there is a lot of issues with fish. I mean, they fish in the morning, they keep the fish with sand, basically, until like afternoon, and then they bring it to the market. And they finally put it on coal. A lot of these fish is going, oh, this is the sand, but they help the fish. A lot of times it gets spoiled. So, you know, we need to get sure that there is like a coal chain to be sure that the fish is going to be well enough to sell, at least if we want to open markets that are within the supermarkets over there or within some of the markets that are in some of the points in Bata. We need to be sure that there is a cold chain and all that. And of course, people from the community that don't have any linkage to the market. So basically, they sell the fish that they get to family. So they come back, they say, hey, I got fish, you want it? Yes, I'm going to sell it to some place. They come, they sell the fish, but they not really get it. They're not really thinking almost like a small enterprise. They're almost family ties that are going on around. Of course, when we try to think about that, we think about exactly what is happening, what we need in transportation, in production, distribution, who's selling. Something cool about the selling is that there are people from Bayan Selam. Bayan Selam sounds like an African, but it's actually buy and sell. They adopt the word and they call it Bayan Selams. So the Bayan Selams are actually the ones that get the distribution. That's why a lot of the women are the ones that are actually working in this part. And transport is pretty much men. There's not too many women driving over there, basically. Of course, most of the fishing is done by men or teenagers. When you see that, and then you try to see, okay, who actually can do this, can help at some point. And I put WCS. I told them that WCS in this river. So I'm trying to say, okay, who else can actually help here that's going to be here, staying here? And that's where we're trying to create the capacity in the government, not only in the port, but in some other stuff, just to be sure that this is going to be a continuing effort, not just for the life of the project. Which is my experience in Central America, with Guatemala, Honduras, and also out of Mexico, that everything works when the project is coming, which is like a subsidizing something, and then the project is gone and everything to stop. So we're trying to avoid that. We'll see the time, and 5 years later we'll see what happened with that. Of course, even though in the force say that they have 125 people on paper, it's a lot of corruption. Probably I'll say probably 40% of the people they are only on paper. They never at the office. They're like a nephew of a ministry, a nephew or a niece of somebody, or a friend of somebody, and they are on they get paid by the port, but they never in the office. So basically the people that you've seen over there is probably most people that show in the office, which is 40. And then they have another probably 30 people that are on the field that you can actually go get and never in the office, but that's 70. You have 125, It's really hard to get all see where exactly. So, on top of the whatever is happening, just having these people having the resources of the government going to a good place for the population is going to be hard because you are actually battling against the director, this guy over here, Fidel, which is really key to conservation and was the one that signed the agreement between WCS and the Ford. I went to his office one time and I was like, okay, Fidel, we really need a way to improve money that's getting to the park. I mean, we cannot really keep trying to get conservation and presence in the area before the money is going to get spread in something that is not conservation. And he told me, well, that's Guinea Elohim, which is made like a study of people from Guinea, well, in a way, a mocking way. Basically, what he's trying to say is that everybody needs a little piece of the pie in order to get into conservation, which, of course, the national fund is going to be, okay, 40% is going to be Greece money, and the other 60% is going to be 20% for the international NGO, which I don't know, actually, I don't know, but, you know, we also get, you know, the management account. So, and then the other 40% goes into whatever it is, but then you have to give all the technical assistance, keep the office in the country and everything else. So when, at the end, the money actually goes into conservation. So we need to think about novel ways to actually get this money into conservation in a way that I can have an impact. I'll probably take any questions after that. I take any questions or whatever, and if a common question I have also a whole table that I want to show you about the areas and which one have managed the plans and which one not, which is really, most of them they are only able to have any management plan going on. So,